exhibition one. It's not in session.
Good morning. Please be seated. This is the time set for oral argument in Cross versus EORP, our cause number 1CA CV 12-0884. Council, as you may be aware, we've recently begun to videotape these arguments, so if you'd do us the courtesy of announcing your appearance and that of the party you represent when you approach the podium, we'd appreciate it. We have certainly read the briefs and conferenced the case before coming into argument today, so we're up to speed on the issues, and you can bear that in mind as you present. Each side has 20 minutes, and the appellant may reserve as much time as you wish for a rebuttal, but the time remaining on the clock when you sit down is the time you have. So with that, we can begin.
Good morning. May it please the court, Michael Silliman from the law firm QTAC Rock on behalf of the appellant elected officials retirement plan. Your honors, this is a case about pension spiking and double dipping in the extreme. Over an 8-year period, the former administrator of the system received in excess of $600,000 in excessive pension benefits. The primary issues in these are numerous, but I'd like to summarize them and then concentrate on some of them unless you have questions. The first issue is, did PSPRS, the system or the plan, change the contract rights by denying retirement in 2002 and seeking reimbursement of the excess payments? The second issue, did Cross really retire in 2002 or did he retire in 2004? And whether he should have received the retirement benefits between that time period. The third issue, whether the salary for pension benefit calculation purposes should have included bonuses, sick pay, and vacation lump sum payments. The fourth issue, if the court determines that lump sum payments should have been included in the calculation of pension benefits, is that salary capped by federal guidelines? Five, whether estoppel under the circumstances is applicable. Six, whether the issue of final annual salary or average last 3 years is properly before the court. And the final issue is whether prejudgment interest is at 4.25% or 10%, and is there a cap on attorney's fees? I'd like to focus first on whether Mr. Cross actually retired in the year 2002. Cross alleges he retired on June 30th, 2002. On July 2nd, that same year, he resumed the same job, with the same duties, with the same title, with the same salary, with the same benefits. ARS 38805 states that a member must cease to hold office in order to be eligible for a pension. There's no way Mr. Cross could have been eligible for a pension under that statutory provision when he maintained his same job, same duties, same salary. The term cease to hold office is not defined by statute, but it is neither ambiguous nor unclear. One cannot cease to hold office when you continue to hold the same office.
It makes a little bit more sense when you're talking about an actual office holder. I mean, Mr. Cross is unique, right? Because he doesn't hold office in the normal sense of the word as it would apply to elected officials.
He is defined as an elected official under the statute, but he is not an elected official as we normally consider that. Yes, that's correct. Okay. The IRS and federal courts have interpreted similar terms such as cease to hold office, including separation from service. And the cases that we've cited in our brief all reach the same conclusion, and that is you can't separate from service unless you've ceased to work for your employer. If you have an explicit understanding that you will return to the same job, same duties, same salary after you've retired, that is not a cessation of work, or it's not a separation of service.
Does it make a difference that he was deemed in some paperwork, I think, to be an interim administrator, or does it make a difference that he the argument he makes is that he had more duties because he was assisting in this search for a replacement.
No, it makes no difference whatsoever. An interim administrator, he himself indicated that he had to be administrator, otherwise his position was illegal. That's what he stated in some of the documents that we've submitted.
He wouldn't have the power to do what he was going to do.
Right, he wouldn't have the power to do it. He wouldn't have the authority or reason to obtain bonuses, for example, was his argument. He had to be the administrator. The appellee points to a particular statute that says that this is the reason he was authorized to be appointed after he retired. And that statute, 38804L, says, was addressing a very different situation. That statute was in response to a Yavapai County supervisor who retired, who was then replaced by an elected supervisor. That supervisor then left office, and the county reappointed the retired member. The statute was passed to address the situation of that nature, but the statute requires, before you can be eligible under that statute, that you be a retired member. Mr. Cross was not a retired member because he didn't cease to hold office, so the statute is inapplicable to him.
Theoretical problem I'm having here is that perhaps the statute that you just referenced acknowledges that there are circumstances under which we will allow a member to retire and come back and continue benefits. So who are we as a court to say whether the member needs to be retired for whatever it was in that situation, a year or two, in the Yavapai County situation, or a moment or two? Who are we as a court to decide?
Well, you as a court decide what the meaning of cease to hold office is. And you can't cease to hold office when the understanding is that you will immediately return to the same position. The case law that we've cited, both state case law in other jurisdictions and federal interpretations of similar terms, all say you cannot have an agreement to remain on the job and at the same time be considered retired. The statute says specifically that you have to be a retired member in order to assume the same job and receive a salary and your pension.
So you don't get to the Yavapai situation unless you are retired.
Unless you are actually retired. Absolutely.
So what if he had left for a week?
Well, if there is an explicit understanding that he was going to return, the federal statutes indicate that that is not appropriate. If you have an understanding that you are going to return to the same position, then you are not considered to be retired.
Doesn't that argument leave the plan in a bind? Because in essence, the administrator or director comes in and says, okay, I'm retiring as of this date. The plan then has to had better hire a new administrator, a new director, before that retirement date, because otherwise they will not have a director.
But we don't have that situation here. There was an explicit understanding.
I understand that, but I mean, it does put your client into a bind then, doesn't it?
Well, it would put the client in the bind if they didn't have an administrator to fill a position.
Right.
But that's not the position that we're in, and that's not the situation or circumstances we are in, because there was an explicit understanding that he was going to return the day after he retired. I'd like to next address the bonus, vacation, and sick leave pay as being included in calculating pension benefits.
Well, let's assume that it should be based on, the benefit should be based on base pay.
Yes.
Isn't Mr. Cross entitled to a refund of all his contributions that were based, and as I understand it, the contributions were based on bonuses, vacation, and sick leave. Wouldn't he be entitled to a refund?
Yes.
Of all those funds with interest?
Yes. Okay. And that's been calculated in the revisions of his applicable pension, what it should have been.
And how much?
I can't tell you offhand. It would be 7% of the amount that was imposed on that the bonuses, sick leave, and vacation.
The $600,000 that we plan seeking to recoup.
We're seeking to recoup over $600,000 after those
Oh, that's pension. Net of recoupment of
yes
of contributions, excess contributions.
Yes.
How long was Mr. Cross employed by the plan?
1986, I believe, to
15.
Yeah, oh, 16 years.
And then he bought time, right?
Really? So the 600 is net of, well, that's just what you said.
Yeah.
There are, of excess contributions.
There are 2 years we claim he was not retired. He received benefits. That has to be returned. And then we're saying that the calculation of his monthly benefit amount should have been reduced because they should not have included bonus vacation and sick leave
right.
in averaging his three-year average.
But, and then he would get back. Okay, $600,000 recognizes that it's after he gets back the amounts that were his amount of his contributions based
That's correct.
On anything beyond base pay.
That's correct. That's correct. The legislative history of the change from base salary to salary, I think it makes it fairly clear that this was just an attempt to conform the statutes to read identical. So they meant salary, and some didn't say base salary, and they all said salary. The plain meaning of salary excludes bonus vacation and sick leave lump sum payments. And I think every court that we've cited in other jurisdictions has arrived at the same conclusion, that these do not include pensionable income for purposes of calculating the benefit due upon retirement. Every case arrives at the same conclusion. The third issue I'd like to address is the Internal Revenue Code limits on compensation used to calculate retirement benefits. In a governmental defined benefit context, a qualified retirement plan has to use IRC Section 401A17, which is the maximum compensation limits when calculating a participant's benefit, regardless of what he is actually earning. The individuals who earn more than the annual compensation limit are restricted in the amount of the benefits that they can receive. And we've given in, samples of that in that from July 1999 to 2000, the compensation limits under the federal code was $160,000. From 2000 to 2002, it was $170,000. And from 2002 to 2004, the limit was $200,000. If Cross's salary is determined as not including bonus vacation and sick leave lump sum payments, then he did not exceed those limits and the IRC compensation limits are irrelevant. But if you do include those in his compensation, then the compensation limits must be applied for those years, 2000.
So the payments during the 2 years violated the IRC's
rule? That's correct.
Does the record tell us about what, how the plan could have done that, or what features there are to prevent
well,
violations?
Well, you have to understand that Mr. Cross was the administrator of the plan at the time. He was responsible for the employees, and he was responsible ultimately for the calculations. So either it was not understood at the time, or it was understood and ignored.
That's an either-or argument. I mean, you're saying either you don't include, you base the contributions only on base pay, or if you're wrong on that, we then have to apply the IRS cap.
That's correct. That's correct. The next issue I'd like to address is estoppel. Estoppel is not applicable against the state or its agencies under the circumstances of this case. And I think the primary case that addresses this issue is the Valencia case. And the Valencia case said, although it remanded for further proceedings, it did say that a state's solvency is of paramount importance and equity will not sacrifice the fundamental welfare of the whole community to accomplish justice for an individual. It also said that a substantial detriment to a party claiming estoppel requires a positional change not required by law. This positional change is required by law. There's no detriment.
But his positional change is that he spent the money, isn't it?
No, the positional change is compelled by law is that he was restricted in the calculation of his benefits.
Oh, I see, yeah.
There's no detriment when his only injury is that he must pay back what he received in excess of what he should have received.
But presumably he made finance when he decided to retire, and he's basing it on this amount. He's making certain fundamental assumptions, as probably all of us do when we're approaching retirement, saying, okay, how much is my pension going to be? Should I retire now? Should I stay at the same income? Or should I rely on my retirement? How much, you know, what should I invest things in? I mean, clearly there could have been factors like that that would show a detriment, right? A detriment of reliance.
There could be a detriment to the individual, but should the community as a whole, the elected officials' retirement plan, suffer at the expense of a detriment to the individual? The Valencia case says no. That's a consideration.
Doesn't the Valencia case say the solvency?
It says state solvency.
Is that right?
Yes, it does say
it. Is the solvency of the plan at issue because of this, because of these excess payments?
Well, it certainly affects the bottom line.
Everything affects the bottom line.
Well,
I mean, them paying your attorney's fees affects the bottom line.
That's true.
But does it affect the solvency of it, the fact that they made a mistake in this one case?
That's true. But the Valencia case goes on to say that it's not, You generally do not impose estoppel against a governmental agency, particularly when it's trying to collect monies that have been overpaid in violation of law. And that's what we're trying to do in this case.
Mr. Silliman, what effect does the trial court's finding of estoppel have here? It was an alternative finding, to be sure, but it's an exercise of the trial court's equity discretion. I guess my point is, and we'll give you more time. This is our last argument of the day, so the other one canceled. So, I probably shouldn't have said that right now. Are we bound by that? Is the point?
No, you're not bound by that.
Why not?
You can review the estoppel decision by the trial court judge. In particular, based on other decisions that he's made that really are contrary to both the state of the law and the statutes, you're not bound by the decision of the trial court.
I'm sorry, other decisions he's made in this case or other?
In this case. Well, the other decisions would relate to the how you calculate benefits, whether you include,
you mean we don't owe them deference?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
But what's the fact that we don't really have any findings as far as equitable estoppel? I mean, didn't the court just say?
Well, he made that finding.
He made that finding, but he didn't make any factual underpinnings. I mean, if we decide this case and say, gee, you know, equitable estoppel, there's an issue of equitable estoppel that has to be decided. Do we remand it for further proceedings?
I believe that this court can overturn the trial court's decision based on the facts that have been established at the trial court and the failure of the judge to interpret correctly the statutes regarding pension benefits. I would like to just address quickly, unless you have questions, the cap on attorney's fees. It's clear that 12.348 applies to administrative reviews, and the cap is $75 per hour. The only reason to change that would be if an increase in cost of living justifies that, or if it's justified for special factors such as limited availability of qualified attorneys. If you agree that the cost of living justifies, the only factual representation was that $75 would be $194.79, which is much less than what was awarded. Secondly, the increase cannot be justified for special factors since limited such as limited availability of qualified attorneys, because that was not an argument that was made in the trial court. The argument that was made was that you can't find somebody to do this work for $75 an hour, not that there weren't qualified attorneys available to do this kind of a case. The final issue is prejudgment interest.
It would be a little ironic if this case, of all the cases we've had, is the one that causes us to have to interpret the statute. But do you have a theory for how it should be interpreted?
Yes. My theory is that the statute should be interpreted such that prejudgment interest on loans, indebtedness, or similar obligations can be at the 10%, but on all other judgments, such as administrative decisions, in this case, should be at the 4.25%. This is not a loan or indebtedness in the common interpretation of those terms.
Right.
So it should not fall under the provisions of A.
Is it an obligation, though? That's the problematic.
Well, this is not the clearest statute that's ever been written by the legislature, and there is nothing that has defined how this works. But I think an argument can be effectively made that if you specify a particular type of judgment that is subject to 10% versus a judgment that's subject to 4.25%, that you can argue that only loans or indebtedness or similar obligations.
Similar
to loans and indebtedness. This is not similar to a loan or indebtedness, which would justify a 10% interest rate.
Let me go back. I know you're out of time, but the equitable estoppel issue.
Yes.
As I understand this, and my understanding may be wrong, so correct me. Technically, there weren't administrative hearings in this. This isn't your typical administrative review where there's administrative hearings. There was a sort of basically a protest about, no, you shouldn't be taking my, Mr. Cross saying, no, I shouldn't be taking, seeking recruitment. It then goes to the trial court as a review of an administrative decision.
That's correct. Fair?
And the trial court did the trial court actually have an evidentiary hearing?
No, it didn't have an evidentiary hearing. The determination, however, at the plan level was pursuant to the rules and regulations adopted by the plan, which said if you want a hearing, you have to request one in such a period of time, or this determination becomes final.
Right.
No such
judicial review.
Correct. No such request was made, so the determination became final under the rules adopted by the plan.
But the trial court could have had an evidentiary hearing on issues of equitable estoppel, couldn't it have?
It could have, it did not.
Did anyone ask for an evidentiary hearing on equitable estoppel?
No.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. We'll be understanding with regard to rebuttal time. Our clock system hasn't worked as it normally does in this case. But we'll give you a few moments.
Good morning, Your Honors. I'm Ron Kilgard from the Phoenix office of Keller Rohrbach. I take your point, Judge Swan, that you all have been through the briefs and have conferenced the case. This is a case, as Michael's recitation at the beginning makes pretty clear, with a lot of issues, and a lot of those have sub-issues. I can't possibly cover all of those in the time allotted, and don't want to. The briefs cover all the issues. The three things I'd like to talk about, as to which there's virtually no overlap with Michael, ironically, are the procedural posture of the case, which will address some of your concerns, Judge Kessler, and which is a little bit unusual. And then the two threshold issues on whether we even get to these issues about when Jack retired, whether it's total salary or base salary, et cetera. And those threshold issues are, is this a contract that so that the plan and Jack are stuck with the 2002 deal? And if it isn't, do the plan's enabling statutes authorize the recalculation of a benefit 8 years later? Let me start with the procedural posture. Your Honors, I may be a little bit awkward here. I just cannot, these are new reading glasses, and this distance is too far, so I may have to pick it up. All right, let's review the bidding here briefly. Jack starts at the plan in 1983. He becomes administrator in 1986. All the plans, the PSPRS, the CORP, and the EORP. That means when he becomes administrator, he automatically becomes a participant in the plan. He is the only non-elected official in the elected official's retirement plan. I realize in this county and Pima County, to a certain extent, judges aren't exactly elected officials, but Jack is unique in that respect. He works as the administrator. The plan then was a 20 and out plan. It was until recently. That means that except for a few large-hearted individuals, most people find it prudent to stop work after 20 years. Jack approached, he started young, that is true. He approached retirement age, he approached his 20 years, he did buy some additional time. And when that happened in 2002, he notified the board, his boss, that he would be leaving. It is no secret he offered to be interim administrator. They were free. They had plenty of time to either hire him or hire somebody else. The board elected to hire him as interim administrator. So he retired I understand Michael has an argument that he didn't really retire, but everyone thought he retired. Jack thought he retired. The plan thought he retired. Mark Lieberman, the plan's lawyer, thought he retired. And he started getting his benefit in July 2002. He continued work as interim administrator. The initial thought was that it would be 6 months, but it was actually longer. He ended up being there for 2 years. It's not the exact same job. For example, the administrator is a participant in the plan. The interim administrator, and there's a couple of documents in the record that describe the job of interim administrator, is not a participant in the plan. He's a participant in the ASRS. So Jack went from the plan to the ASRS. And part of the job is to find a successor.
So those are the two primary differences?
Those are the two primary differences.
Okay.
And speaking of which, I didn't attach this to the appellee's brief. I wish I had, but a handy document in the case is Record of Appeal number 48. It's the statement of facts that Paige Martin, Michael's partner, and I did for the case. So those are the stipulated, agreed upon facts. It's only 5 or 6 pages, and it works chronologically through the whole case. All right, so Michael, Jack is interim administrator, 2 years, then he leaves government service completely. He continues to get his benefit, like clockwork, until he gets quite a shock in November 2010 with a letter from Jim Hackett.
Although at some point your client contacted the plan and said, you know, I'm entitled to more money based on difference of the average of 3 years versus the last year. And then the response was, if I understand it correct, the response was, well, maybe, but, you know, we're going to recoup $600,000.
That's right, Your Honor. I actually don't know how long you've been on the bench, Your Honor, but that issue of final annual salary versus average yearly salary surfaced at about that time. Jack got wind of it. He did do that. His response was this letter from Jim Hacking reducing the benefit, and then that's the first administrative decision, and then the March 2011 letter saying that they were going to catch up by not paying him anything for 4 years. All right, Jack immediately hires counsel, not us, Carson Messenger. They file within a week or so an administrative review complaint. Once the March decision comes out, they file an amended one. So we're up to March, March 2011. Jack hires us, our firm, in May 2011. There's no secret about why he did it. It's in the record. It's in the attorney's fee. He could not possibly afford to defend this as an hourly rate matter. We do contingent work. So we took the case. My concern, and indeed prior counsel's concern too, but my concern immediately was the plan is a public entity. The other cases I've had against the plan preceded as notice of claim, then a lawsuit.
Right.
So I was scared to death that we needed to do something. I made a motion to stay the administrative proceeding. Michael graciously stipulated to it. So we put that on ice. I filed a notice of claim. It's in the record in this case as SIR 162.
But the notice of claim just deals with the contract claim.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
And we're dealing here on the administrative claim.
That's right. We are dealing with that, and part of that, as I will argue in a minute, involves the contractual status of this benefit.
But let me, as you're going, I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, no, please do.
But, I mean, we're somewhat familiar with some of the history, factual history, but I am a little concerned on this equitable estoppel issue, and I know that jumps over some of your other arguments.
Right.
But there was never a hearing per se, as we understand administrative hearings, before the plan.
That's right,
and
Your Honor.
And it gets to the review before the trial court, and there's no evidentiary hearing there as to any issue. Is that correct?
Not, there's no hearing, but there is evidence. Record of Appeal, Item 33, Exhibit 7, is Jack's declaration, uncontested. There was no effort to depose him. It's Record on Appeal, need my glasses here, 33, Exhibit 7. It's a lengthy declaration by Jack explaining a couple of things. One is that the generous retirement benefit was a major factor in him taking this job. Many public pension plan administrators are paid, you know, very differently on percent of asset.
Does anything in that declaration go to the idea of equitable estoppel and detriment and harm?
Yes, it does, Your Honor. I mean, he relying on that, he did not save separately. A public defined benefit pension plan is about as good as it gets in America, except being a federal judge, maybe, in which case your retirement's in the U.S. Constitution. But so he did not save anything. He has a net worth of $10,000. He has his financial statement, his income statement, all of that is attached to that.
Okay.
That was argued to Judge McLennan, but there was no, it was not contested.
Okay.
The plan's argument was, you know, that's too bad. He should have known better. It wasn't, that's not true. There was no such proceeding. As to the standard of review on that, that is a little puzzling. The only case, really, is this Valencia case. There's a footnote in my answering brief. My guess is it's a abuse of discretion standard. I mean, that, but the case doesn't say that, but that seems to be the logic of it.
The logic because
well, the
exercise of discretion is, I mean, the exercise of equitable discretion is by definition discretion.
That's right. That's right. And there is, I'd have to flip over to the brief, but there is in that footnote on the standard of review on equitable stop, I did find another case that had some bearing on it, but there wasn't much. I was a little puzzled by it. So we filed the notice of claim. 60 days goes by. We file the contract case. That's in this record as Record on Appeal 33, Exhibit 3. Then we went back to see Judge McLennan. He had both cases. We figured out what to do about it. Over my objection, Judge McLennan stayed the contract case and litigated the administrative review case. I wanted to do it the other way, but that's how he wanted to do it. The issues that you're hearing about in this case were basically heard about in that case. Judge McLennan entered his minute entry, agreeing that both the plan and Jack were stuck with the 2002 deal. But he also held in the alternative, and this is where I disagree with, well, I disagree a lot with Michael, but on this specific thing in the briefs, he also held in the alternative that if that was wrong, then he would look under the hood and turn to these other issues, date of retirement, base pay versus total pay, and so on. And one of those was final annual salary versus average yearly salary. and Judge McLennan concluded that if Cross contends if his retirement benefits are recalculated, they should be based on final annual salary, and then he says he agrees with that. The judgment that was then entered is the judgment I requested and submitted for the 2002 deal. That's what I wanted. The judgment doesn't say if this judgment is wrong, then there's this alternative calculation, but that is what Judge McLennan held.
You keep calling it the deal. All right, finish your comment, but we're now more than 50% through the allotted time, and I do want to get to some substantive issues.
All right, very well, Your Honor. My point in mentioning it is this cross-appeal issue. I mean, I know appellate courts are concerned about their jurisdiction. Michael mentions there should have been a cross-appeal here. I don't think that's correct. We are not aggrieved by the judgment at all. I mean, it's exactly the judgment we wanted, and the background minute entry is exactly the minute entry we wanted.
Okay.
Yes, Your Honor.
What is the relevance of the fact that there's a companion contract action? Is that argument made simply to drive home that this is a contract case for purposes of the fees, or is there something else?
Well, it's part of that. It's a contract case as part of the fees. The importance, well, for the fees, but also the fact that it's a contract case, and that affects how the administrative review works, which I'll turn to now to respond to your question.
Yeah, let's actually focus on the issues before us. You keep referring to a 2002 deal, and my understanding is that your position is that some contract was formed on the date of the intended retirement with regard to future benefits. Is that correct?
That's exactly correct,
okay.
Your Honor.
What was the consideration that Mr. Cross gave for that contract?
A lifetime of service.
No, he gave that in exchange for the benefits that the law allows. A contract was clearly formed for his participation in the plan as he continued his employment. There's no question about that. But I don't get where a new contract was formed merely by the fact that he decided to start accepting benefits.
Well, let me tackle that, Your Honor. I mean, in Arizona, we have Article 29 in our Constitution. There's only a few other states have comparable provisions. It says a variety of things, but one of them is that membership in a public retirement system is a contractual relationship.
There's no question about that.
So what's the contract here? What are the contract documents?
I think the existing case law says that the contract is formed at the time of employment, and once the employment relationship begins, the rights that the pension statutes give the employee at that time become part of the contract. And I don't mean to challenge that notion for a moment, but I am at a loss to understand why there's a new contract.
There's not a new contract, Your Honor. I mean the contract was finally documented and finally vested in the meaning of the vesting statute in 2002 when the documents that are attached to the answering brief were executed.
Finally vested, what you mean, I take it, is that there was a vested right to receive the benefits that the plan provides.
Correct.
Not a special deal that Mr. Cross worked out. Each time you say the 2002 deal, I'm wondering how it is that Mr. Cross gets to make his own deal on the date of his purported retirement when the statutes provide the benefits that all members are entitled to.
Well, Your Honor, that's correct. And suppose the contract documents that are attached to the answering brief had been mistaken. Suppose they had been inconsistent with his rights under Yeezel.
Suppose that on the date of his retirement, somebody made a data entry error, and instead of a period 00, put a comma 00, and suddenly the benefits are 100 times what they're supposed to be.
Your Honor, that is a mistake. And that is the type of mistake the law of contracts is well supplied to deal with. That would be a Scribner's error in contract formation. Many cases explain how you reform contracts. The cases that are in Michael's brief are mostly cases like that, or mistakes in performance.
And is it a Scrivener's error in contract formation, or would that be a Scrivener's error in benefit administration? Those seem to be two very different concepts.
Your Honor, they're right. They're two different concepts, but they are both concepts for which the law of mistake routinely gives relief. Here, I mean, for example, one of Michael's cases, my favorite case in the briefs, is the New York retirement case. School teacher in New York retires to Arizona, gets her pension, and in each envelope there are two checks, two identical checks. She cashes them for 11 years. Incredible chutzpah. New York finally catches on to this and naturally wants its money back. That's a mistake in performance for which the law, the ordinary contract law, gives a remedy. But what's the mistake here? Michael concedes in the brief it's a unilateral mistake as to a matter of law.
So it's unilateral on whose side?
The plans.
The plan.
The plan was membership in a public retirement system is a contractual relationship. One member of the contract is Jack, the other is the plan.
I hate to say it, but there's an elephant in the room. Right? I mean, the plan is being run by Mr. Cross.
It isn't being run by Mr. Cross. It's run by the board, which has Mark Lieberman as one of the best-known public pension plan lawyers in America as its counsel. Mm-hmm. Jack did not sign on behalf of the plan. The acting administrator, I forget who it is, but it's in the documents. There is no evidence in this record at all. And in fact,
I'm not suggesting some sort of improper collusion, but when we talk about contract doctrine of unilateral mistake, it's difficult for me to see how the understanding of the plan by Mr. Cross and the understanding of the plan qua plan are different.
They are different. They're different human beings, Your Honor. One is the board charged by law with running this plan.
Not a human being. One's an entity administered by a human being.
No, that's not correct, Your Honor. Jack is the administrator of the plan, the financial administrator of the plan. The governing body of the plan is the board. They hired Jack. They run the plan. They're responsible for it. They have lawyers. Mm-hmm. They contracted with their employee, Jack Cross, and this is the result. They made the mistake, not Jack. Indeed, it's a little funny. I don't think there was a mistake. I think everything was correct except the final salary.
What were you done, Peter? I didn't mean to.
Go ahead.
I want to get away from this idea that, well, when the 2002 documents were signed, that created a new contract. Because you admitted that, I think you can see that didn't create a new contract. It basically confirmed the contract that was in existence.
That's right, Your Honor.
But you say, if I wrote it down correctly, I think you said that he had a vested right to receive the benefits the plan provides. That was the contract. The contract when he started work was you will have a vested right to receive the benefits the plan provides. And the problem here is, as I see it, is if he didn't actually retire as a matter of law, he was getting benefits that the statutory plan did not provide.
Were this a jurisdiction in which there were not this constitutional contractual overlay, I would agree with Your Honor. Now, I hasten to add, of course, as you know from the answering brief, he did retire in 2002. There is,
sure
they're
I
mean, absolutely
but
wrong
let's
about
assume,
that.
We're assuming for purposes of
let's
my statement
assume.
That he didn't.
But if all that has happened is the plan through its new administrator, or the board, has decided that it was incorrect interpreting a legal issue 8 years earlier. 8 years earlier, and not even based on a new case, not even based on a new statute, simply retrospectively reviewing the law. There's both viewed as a contract issue and viewed under the authorization statutes, there's a specific statute dealing with correction of pension plan errors. And it requires, I need to put my glasses back on, it requires incorrect information. And that's not what's...
I saw that, but that's assuming that there's a unilateral, to me it assumes, there's a unilateral mistake once they confirm up his benefits. But if all the statutes are read into the contract and the contract is formed at the time of the his employment, it means that if we determine that he didn't retire, then he is entitled to benefits based on retirement when in 2002. And every, I mean, so it's, and what we're saying is your argument basically, I think, is saying is, and no one can correct that.
No one can correct that type of mistake. Other types
and
of mistakes.
The court can't correct it. Even though the statutes are read into the contract, the court can't correct it.
Yes, Your Honor, that is my argument. Otherwise, there's no meat to the vesting statute. Every retirement pension plan is always at risk of an administrator, a board, concluding retrospectively that what a statute meant 10 years ago, we've got a different wrinkle on it.
The vesting statute, though, I don't see that the vesting statute is really at the center of this argument, because all the vesting statute does is say your rights to receive the benefits under the plan vest. In other words, you can receive them. It seems to state the obvious, right? You can receive the benefits when you retire. It doesn't say that your first check is your guaranteed check for life. The vesting statute doesn't say what vests. It really says what doesn't vest. And that's your right to receive payments before retirement, which I think everybody would pretty much take for granted. But it strikes me as a way of clarifying the obvious for tax reasons.
The vesting statute is a interesting creature. I'd be happy to give you my take on it. The relevance here, I think, is that Jack is in the unusual position of being essentially super vested. He's vested because under Yeazell, everyone vests on the first day of employment. Opinion divides on what the 2000 vesting statute means. Judge Reyes thinks it means essentially not much, just ordinary vesting. You don't get the checks until you fill out the forms. The plan, in other litigation, has taken the position that it doesn't mean that, that if you're a member of the plan after 2000, caveat emptor, you have no, it effectively overrules yourself. Here, though, that interesting debate isn't at issue. Jack is vested in both ways, and my argument is simply that given the specific statute for the correction of pension plan errors, which seems not to apply here, given the fact that he is vested any which way you look at it, that has to mean something. I agree
it
means you can correct Scrivener's errors.
Well, doesn't vesting, though, let's assume that you're right, that he's super vested. Doesn't vesting mean that his benefits can't be reduced by a change in the plan? Doesn't mean that he gets free money if the plan makes a mistake.
On this set of facts, I think it does mean that, Your Honor. Judge Meyerson's opinion and fund manager, the cases from New York and Illinois cited in the footnotes say that what this means is neither the legislature, the employee, nor the employer can change the deal.
Precisely. But is the deal being changed, or is the deal being enforced according to its terms? That's really the question.
Well, that is the question. I agree there.
But I think that's an important one, because if the deal were being changed, I think the only entity capable of doing that is the legislature. And as you point out, because he's vested, the legislature might be incapable of doing that. But if the deal is merely being enforced according to its terms, does the vesting even have any relevance?
I think it does, Your Honor. I think it is an additional protection for the retiree to give additional comfort that I've worked my career, I filled out the paperwork, it's been approved. Absent Scribner's errors, two checks in the envelope, that sort of thing, this is my benefit. I can plan the rest of my life on it.
What,
Yes.
Why is your argument that assuming there's a contract, assuming that the benefit paperwork created a contract, why is there a unilateral error in that instead of a bilateral mistake? Because Mr. Cross doesn't, his contention is he didn't know how the statute was going to be interpreted either.
His contention is they did it correctly.
So,
I mean, he doesn't think there was a mistake.
But if a court sometime says to the contrary, this would be a bilateral mistake, right?
I'm not quite sure how to get my head around that, Your Honor. I mean, the plan has decided. The plan has issued a lengthy letter interpreting the law in 2010 that is inconsistent with its earlier position. The plan contends that it made a mistake as to law. If this court were to decide, yes, it should have been base salary, not total salary, then I would lose on that issue, but for these predecessor arguments of the Constitution and whether that's the type of incorrect information that permits change in benefits.
But the idea of a unilateral mistake as to when he's retired, because I think that's at least what I was interpreting one of the issues to be here, is a bilateral mistake. Because the plan thought, oh, he retired in 2000, originally thought, oh, he retired in 2002. And Mr. Cross thought, hey, I retired in 2002. And in fact, if the law is different and that's not a retirement when he starts work the next day as the interim administrator, it's a bilateral mistake. Isn't that right? And
well,
he hasn't retired.
I guess that's
then
right,
Then you see the dominoes falling. I mean, if he hasn't retired, then he wouldn't be entitled to benefits based on that retirement.
That's right, Your Honor. I can't disagree with that.
Thank you very much for your patience.
Let me just ask you, do you have a theory for interpreting the interest statute?
Boy, that is a puzzler. It looks like it's a drafting mistake in the statute by referring to those two provisions. I think it has to mean that this was an obligation. If they owe him the money, I don't see how it's an obligation, and so that it should be the 10% rate. Incidentally, the 10% rate is the rate the plan used when they did the $600,000 calculation. So I don't. I'm sort of at a loss beyond what I said in the brief on it. Thank you very much, Your Honor. It's a pleasure to be in front of you.
A few minutes.
I'll be real quick because I know we've gone over time. I know the court is concerned about the equitable estoppel argument, but even if you rule that equitable estoppel is applicable in this situation as to collection of past overpayments, it shouldn't affect the recalculation as to his future payments based on the same arguments. Other than that, if you have questions of me.
Just one. 38810.04, retired member returned to work.
Yes. I've got it.
Does this cloud the seeming clarity of your argument on retirement, the definition of retirement?
I'm sorry, I may have to borrow that after all.
Sure.
38810.04.
Right. A.
I'm sorry, there's no A.
It might be in the pocket.
In the pocket. This was added in 2011, apparently. I don't think it's applicable to our situation since the retirement occurred in 2004.
Fair answer.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, counsel, for your arguments. Very helpful. We appreciate them. The matter is now under advisement. We'll issue a ruling in due course, and we stand adjourned.